Hello and welcome to the India Hangout. Now, there have been three crashes in the space of almost a week. One of them was because of a missile strike and therefore perhaps was a little different. The other two were more natural, perhaps, if you want to use that word. TransAsia Airways flight going into Taiwan, Penghu, Taiwan, 48 out of 58 people killed when the aircraft was coming on a go-around. The other one was then Air Algiers, 116 people killed in when the plane crashed or the aircraft crashed in northern Mali. The question, of course, that we're asking today is air travel getting more unsafe, or should we be concerned given the unusually high number of problems that we've seen? Joining me now to discuss this and understand this a little better, Saroj Datta, former director of Jet Airways, Devesh Agarwal of Bangalore Aviation, the website, and also an aviation enthusiast. Also Prasanto K. Roy from PKR from Delhi, also an aviation enthusiast and a keen tracker of the statistical side of what's been happening. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Prasanto, let me sort of begin with you. Take us through the what's been happening. I mean, you know, the numbers which are so staggering, I mean, or appearing so staggering, because we've seen so many aircraft crashing, so many lives lost, all in a matter of such a short time.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy. You know, statistically, it's still very safe given the sheer numbers. You know, the percentage of fatalities has actually come down significantly over the years, and it continues to. Right. But that's obviously no consolation in terms of either the numbers, the families of the victims, or the fact that, you know, there have been four almost in quick succession. If you actually look at the sky today, and we've got a lot of real-time trackers like Flight 24, you know, Flight Radar 24, etc., it's actually very scary to see the mass of flights which are there. And, you know, the sheer the lack of control of the kind of control you would expect in a well-monitored, you know, a flight area or an airport or, you know, metros or the Western countries, you know, they may not exist in all of the air corridors. Mm-hmm. So given that fact, it's actually not surprising. I mean, it's in fact surprising that there aren't more, at least near misses or maybe worse. I think we will need to use these as cases which will look at a significant overall of things, including what happened with MH17, where, you know, I mean, clearly there is an IFF code, there is an identification code which is there, and that was not picked up and it was simply ignored by these guys. So there's been four different things that have happened, but they all point to the fact that air travel is a very high density phenomenon today, and that high density is itself scary and is likely to lead to more and more incidents, even if they're a very small percentage of the total number of flights and travelers.
Right. Okay. Devesh, I know that you've come in from a long haul flight from Bangalore and now are in Las Vegas. So you've, and I know that you're also a monster frequent flyer. So any trepidation before you boarded this flight?
No. There's definitely an aberration this year, Govind. Of course, none of the 298 passengers on board MH17, and as I said, first, condolences to their families. Nobody expected them that a bunch of Ukrainian nut jobs would, you know, go and take an SA-11 Buk missile from Russian nut jobs and then go and blow this thing. Prasanto was talking about setting up, an IFF kind of code. Well, IFF is used by the military, and they also use a similar transponder system, except on a different set of frequencies when compared to the civilians.
Right.
So it's not that the civilian airlines do not use transponders. They do use transponders. They are identified. And even if you see, I don't know if the government ever would allow civilians to just visit an ATC to see the kind of work that goes on. But there is a reason why aviation is so safe today. It is because of the number of accidents that have occurred through the years. And each time an accident occurs, it becomes an international learning incident.
Right.
An accident or an incident is always sort of a result of events that were not seen or thought of before.
Right, Devesh, that's a fair point, but let me interrupt you there. The question I'm trying to ask is, are we seeing a theme in what's been happening? And I'm going to put the question to Saroj Datta shortly as well. But the question is really, Devesh, in the case of Malaysian Airlines, the argument is that if the airline had been very cautious, they could have perhaps avoided that airspace, as many other airlines did. Like, for instance, some of the American airlines, some of the Asian airlines like Asiana and Cathay Pacific. Now, this is one part of it. The other two, of course, are to do with a combination of maybe pilot error or mechanical error combined with maybe an environmental problem, which is an atmospheric problem. Again, it could point to the fact that this could have been avoided. I mean, is that a fair proposition, Devesh?
Well, you see, partly, but I completely disagree with your fundamental thing that when you were mentioning, I remember, I think in an earlier hangout, see, Asiana and Qantas and all of these, a lot of these airlines, they did not have the flight paths taking them over Ukraine at all. It's not that they voluntarily, per se, quote unquote, chose to avoid Ukraine.
Right.
Because the airspace in Ukraine was cleared by the ICAO, which is the International Civil Aviation Organization, mm-hmm. above flight level 320, that is 32,000 feet. Mm-hmm. So once you have such high, I mean, when you have clearances from Eurocontrol, you have clearances from the ICAO, why should an airline not trust these two, authorities who are essentially responsible for that region? If you go back and see the radar data, whether it is flight tracker, flight aware, flight radar 24.
Right.
I mean, our own prime minister was flying through that own airspace. So
right.
Why should we have a doubt that did, I, honest to God, do not hold Malaysian Airlines in any way, shape or form culpable
right.
in the case of MH17. It was a sheer case of having the bad luck of being in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Right, right. Okay.
That's about it.
Fair enough, Devesh. I'll come back to you on this in a moment. Let's go to Saroj Datta. Mr. Datta, thank you very much for joining us. A general question first. I mean, we've obviously seen three incidents involving a large loss of lives of passengers, unfortunately, and our thoughts and prayers are with them. But should passengers be concerned as they go, I mean, as they embark, I mean, onto aircraft in coming days and in the days ahead?
Well, in my opinion, not particularly, because I think these things have been happening over the, in aviation history, have been happening over a period of time. And these accidents happen in a bunch. I've seen it happening in bunches, three or four at a time, usually three at a time. I don't know why. But in this particular case, one accident is obviously man-made. It was definitely an action by one group, probably a mistaken identity of the aircraft. And they probably were trying to attack another aircraft and they hit this MH17 by mistake. But whatever be the reason, it is an unfortunate disaster, and the other two are due to bad weather conditions. That's the Taiwan one, AirAsia, and the other one, TransAsia or whatever, and the other one is the Algeria.
Right. Okay. Subhash Goyal of STIC joins us as well. Mr. Goyal, thank you very much for joining us once again. So we went through this subject a few days ago when we were talking about the Malaysian airline downing.
Sure.
We've had now two more crashes to reckon with. Does this, in your mind, cause any concern? Is there should passengers be worried? And if so, what should they be doing?
Passengers very much worried. I think what is important, as rightly mentioned, that you see, whether the accident is, because of weather or calamities or it's because of human error, right? An accident is an accident and lives are lost and lives are lives. So I think ICAO, the International Civil Aviation Organization, in association with organizations and airlines manufacturers like Airbus and Boeing, have to come up with systems, mainly if a missile or something like that is there, it could be retarded or thrown off or diverted as an anti-missile system. Aircrafts will have to have them, right? Like an anti-collision device they have, something like that has to. Secondly, the weather some strict norms have to be created where aircrafts will not be allowed to fly, if weather is of a particular nature. I mean, it should not be at this time and age and of scientific availability, data availability, no pilot should be able to risk, on his, instincts, a flight to, whether he should take the flight or not.
Right. Okay. So let me, Mr. Goyal, let me interrupt you there for a second, and let me put this question to Mr. Datta as well. Mr. Datta, if you look at the three crashes, and this is the same point I was putting to Devesh earlier, could Malaysian Airlines have avoided that area entirely, because some airlines were avoiding it for sure. The other two, as Mr. Goyal also said, could have been instances where, let's say, if the airlines or the pilots were being very careful, though they may have been in the permissible limits, if they had been very careful, perhaps they would not have either ventured out or not gone on those particular routes. So is that something that should be of concern here?
So that's right. I think it was it's unfortunate that either the pilots were not well informed or they were not adequately trained to avoid these particular situations. I think both the incidents where they could have avoided the particular trips or the particular flight ranges or the flight patterns which they were following, and they could have delayed or avoided those particular flights. I'm not a pilot myself, but delayed those flights or not undertaken those flights and avoided these particular disasters. I don't think there was any reason why this should have happened. The delays could have been, the crashes could have been avoided. So I think. People on the ground could very easily blame it on the pilots, on the air traffic controls or whatever they may be. Except that in one case, I think in the Air Algérie case, I seem to have read that there was a change in the weather conditions in between, whilst the aircraft was already in the air. But even then, I think the flight routing could have possibly been changed, and the route pattern could have been changed and avoided the disaster. Right. But whatever be it, I think it possibly a bit more care, a bit more control over it could have avoided the crash.
Right. So we are obviously going in many of these, actually almost all three cases, with information that we have, except in the case of MH17, we know for sure that the aircraft was hit with a missile, though we still don't know where exactly it came from and who fired it, and not that that is germane to the issue that we're discussing today. But the fact is, at least in these other two cases, we are of course going with the information we have, and we don't have all the details at this point. Devesh, you wanted to say something?
A couple of things. Earlier, when you were talking about Asiana and Qantas, you see, Qantas has most of its, now it has shifted its hub to Dubai.
Right.
So Europe to Dubai route is much more southern. Mm-hmm. If you take the North Asian carriers, whether it is Japan Airlines, Asiana, Korean Airlines, ANA, even China Airlines, they all take a more northern route over Russia because it's the shortest route.
Right.
Personally, that very area where the plane was shot down, I used to fly through that area at least 6 times a year for a period of 10 years.
Okay.
So, and I have flown through with Singapore Airlines, with Lufthansa, with Thai, Swiss Air in those days. Now, I'm sorry, I will completely disagree with Mr. Datta that the pilots were less trained or ill-informed. It was a decision, as I said, nobody expected these Ukrainian separatists to be armed by the Russians with such an advanced, you know, surface-to-air system.
Right, and but I would quote a Bloomberg report which said that. I just wanted to quote. There's no point in going too deep into this point. It's happened already. But I mean, there was a Bloomberg news report which said that there were almost 400 services on that route about a month and a half ago, which had come down to about 100 services when MH17 was downed. And that's really the context one is asking this question.
See, the thing what I'm trying to say is that if you look at the 4 accidents today, we seem to be only focusing on the last 3. We have conveniently and completely forgotten about MH370.
Right. Fair enough.
That is an accident that is of extreme concern because really nobody knows what has happened. In the case of Taiwan, it was a case of, you know, bad weather. And in the case of Mali, even though it was Swift Air who was operating it, and Swift Air has got a good record as an operator, they obviously have flown in and then last minute, it is frequent. You have a major storm in your path, you ask for a deviation. It's a common thing that happens.
Right.
In everyday flying.
Right.
Obviously something. So these two are weather related.
Okay.
MH17 is known. What is known about MH370? Even today, we have absolutely no clue. We don't even know where the plane is.
Right. Okay. Fair enough. So,
one statistic.
Yeah.
Even with 4 accidents this year, we have just about crossed the last 10 years average of 761 fatalities per year.
Right. Okay. But we seem to have crossed it much earlier in the year, right?
Agreed. I'm just saying, despite MH17 really cannot be taken as a classic, airline accident per se.
Right. And I don't know, Devesh, if you recall and if I remember right, today is also the anniversary of the Air France Concorde crash. It's July 25th, 2000, if I'm not mistaken.
Which was, believe it or not, thanks to a small strip of metal dropped by a DC-10 on the runway at Paris.
Right, and today is the anniversary, and that makes it even more poignant in some ways. Prasanto, what's your sense? I mean, see, what we're trying to obviously arrive at is that how do we finally make this safer? One is the safety, the other is how do we feel confident that what has happened is only an aberration, and how can we in some ways reconcile ourselves to the tragedy that has happened?
You know, let's just take these one by one. Now, MH17, the fact is that that whole area, I mean, it was cleared, and including by Eurocontrol, the blackout area, as it were, from zero to flight level, 320, they were flying above that. Now, it's not really happened. I mean, airliner does not expect to be shot down by a SAM, any kind of surface-to-air missile at that altitude of 33,000 or flight level 330.
Right.
You know, you had the example of Iran Air 655, which was shot down by a missile from USS Vincennes that was at a much lower level. There have been other cases which... So, now the thing is, each of these is a learning. It's a learning. Now, clearly, after this incident, the blackout zone for any area where there are insurgents with SA-11 class missiles, which can go to more than twice of flight level 320, will be zero to infinity. It'll be zero to, lower Earth orbit. There's no airliner.
70,000 feet, yeah.
Yeah, 70,000 feet. And keep in mind that in that zone, Air India 001 was about 55 minutes away from the Ukraine FIR,
right,
carrying Prime Modi. Air India 113 was just 24 kilometers or 25 kilometers to one side. That was a 787 Dreamliner. Okay, now I think as Devesh is saying, the biggest mystery to be cracked is really 370, because that is of the greatest concern. these ones have relatively simple answers, except for the AH5017, which we don't know yet exactly what happened with, and the ATR crash in Taiwan.
Right. Yeah, but we'll find out in both cases, because all the black boxes have been recovered, the area has been secured, and so on. Yeah.
They've been recovered. So therefore, 370 is absolutely amazing. You know, this has not happened so far in an incident of this nature. I mean, Air France 447, okay, the crash debris, first debris was found within a week. Hmm. Sure, the black boxes were recovered 2 years later. Yeah. But the fact is that area was known. So you had some idea of what happened and roughly where it happened. 370 is huge. And I think that is a lot of focus will need to be put into recovering and figuring out where that is and then cracking that mystery. Because I think that is where the maximum number of what I call airworthiness directives would come in terms of what needs to be done in terms of connectivity. Inmarsat has already, offered connectivity to aircraft so that the basic information about where the aircraft is actually available at a better resolution than it is. But I think each of these will generate its own set of learnings which would make air travel safer.
Right. Okay, let me come back to Mr. Goyal and... Sorry, yeah.
One quick thing. What he said, in case of AF447, because there was an ACARS set of, ACARS messages over a period of 2 minutes, people knew that there was something technically wrong with the aircraft. The aircraft had destabilized, it entered alternate law, the autopilot had switched off. So people basically had a rough idea as to what had happened to the aircraft, but not exactly why it had happened and what was the final reasons. But in case of 370, we are completely in the dark. Every aviation and safety expert who tries to put forth a theory finds that something else has happened in the 370 incident, which goes against the basic tenets of that theory. So that is why this accident is very crucial to solve.
Right. Okay. So let's come back to Mr. Goyal. We're also sort of running out of time. Mr. Goyal, we started by asking, is air travel, should there be cause for additional worry? You talked about, ICAO playing a more proactive role. You also talked about airlines being more careful about the routing. Is there anything else that you would like to add in order to really encourage those who want to fly and travel to do so without fear?
No, I think when the weather is bad, many a time we have seen planes who were supposed to land in Delhi have been diverted to Jaipur or even Mumbai during the fog time and all. So I think there has to be an international standard where pilots will not take a chance, and whether it's a war zone or whether it's a particular area, by law, it will have to be avoided. Mm-hmm. And secondly, the confidence of passengers who are traveling by air, has become a little shaky, because within a short span, 3-4 major accidents have taken place in which precious human lives have been lost. So this is a very serious matter, and it needs to be looked into. Anyway, this is life, and we have to
get along and move along. Yeah.
People will not stop flying.
Right.
Like after the bombing in London Underground, the traffic in the underground didn't go.
Right.
Down.
Life must go on. Just one angle, and if I can bring Mr. Saroj Datta back here. We've not really talked about this, and it may not be relevant, but could aging aircraft be an issue, particularly in the other two crashes or some of the other accidents that we've seen, and maybe the possibility that the airlines were not paying enough attention? This is not the case in Malaysian, but in maybe the other cases, and your general sense of should passengers be worried about the stock of aircraft that are out there flying in the skies, and whether they're being replenished at the right time?
I doubt very much. I don't think that the fact of aging aircraft is not normally an issue in these cases, because the aging aircraft are under strict checks, under strict controls by the air authorities, not only by the FAA or the CAA conditions that have been laid down, and by the authorities where they are registered, by the air authorities of the countries where they are registered, like the air authorities of India where the aircraft are registered, but similarly of Taiwanese aircraft where it was registered. But and most of the countries follow the FAA registrations and rules and regulations. So I would suspect that the aging of aircraft is a very minor consideration in these issues, in these cases, and they would follow the rules and regulations of the FAA. And most of us means the airlines, avoid aging aircraft. I mean, delay, get those aircraft out of service as soon as possible.
Right. Okay. So that's one angle which should not be of concern, at least the way Saroj Datta puts it. Closing sort of comments from our guest Prasanto. We started by asking, is there cause for concern when it comes to passengers? Is the whole concept of air travel looking a little more shaky? What's your final takeaway on this?
No, absolutely not. I think there's been the world and is led by the United States and the NTSB. They've had a very good record of flight safety and of analyzing and studying and learning from each and every disaster so that nothing is ever repeated. Normally, an air disaster is a sequence of things that go wrong. In the case of MH17, you could argue that flight corridor should not have been routed through a place where you had surface-to-air missiles which go that high, etc. But I hope we've seen the last of this cluster of air disasters at this time. But I think these will be very, very strong learning incidents, and I'm really looking forward to seeing, especially what happens with 370.
Right, Devesh, your last word on this. What's the takeaway? I mean, I know you've got many more flights to catch on this leg.
As I said, I will echo Prasanto's thoughts. Air travel is still the safest mode of transport. Earlier, Prasanto was talking about the sheer volume. On YouTube, there's a video called World Airline Traffic Time-Lapse Video over 24 hours. If you search for it, it is amazing to see the sheer volume of airplanes that are in the sky. And they happen every day because there are safety systems and detailed procedures put into place. Many times we as passengers will fret. We'll say, oh, this guy is sitting at Bombay Airport waiting to get onto the runway while some plane is landing from so far away. These are safety factors that the air traffic control puts in to prevent, this thing, which is learnt over years. So it's a very safe mode of travel, and I'm going to be continuing to travel from Las Vegas. I go to the home of Boeing, which is Seattle, and then again within the United States before flying all the way back to India. And of course, I know that British Airways will probably use the route of Turkey now and not fly over Ukraine when we fly back. But as I said, it is a very safe mode of travel. I don't feel any reason for anybody to feel frightened of this mode of travel.
Right.
They should not be apprehensive at all. This is an aberration that has happened this year.
Right. Okay. Mr. Datta, last point. Your advice to as an airline veteran to those who are taking flights or about to take flights, and what should they be doing, if anything, to better prepare themselves?
Well, I think one of them is, of course, rely on how responsible are the airlines themselves, what reputation the airlines have in terms of both the safety regulations and how strictly they follow those regulations, about the conditions of the aircraft in which they fly, of the countries where they are registered and what sort of regulations they follow, how strictly they follow the FAA regulations, FAA and the UKCA or the European CAA CAE or whatever they call themselves, CAB regulations, and the ICAO regulations, and of course the insurance rules and regulations.
Right, right. Mr. Datta, thank you very much. I think we've run out of time completely. I think the synopsis here seems to be that, we've had a very unfortunate patch and leading to lives lost in the last few days, but that's no reason to fear beyond a point. Air travel continues to be safe, statistically safe. The systems, the people, the processes that are keeping all those aircraft up there and ensuring that they take off and land safely are immense, and there's a lot of knowledge and learning that goes in on a continuous basis, and that's something that you should take some encouragement from. We've run out of time on the India Hangout. Thank you all for joining us today, and we'll be back.